afternoon, everyone. Today I promised that we would go through the first verse of the new Gloria. Again, this is Steve Agrisano's Gloria Mass setting called the Mass of a Joyful Heart. So when you sing, you can smile and bring joy to the Lord by singing his Gloria. Today we have Julia and Adam as our cantors, and they're going to help me sing. And we're going to do, you remember the refrain, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. Let's try that together. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. And then the first verse.
We praise you. We bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father.
Let's try that together.
We praise you, we bless you.
Because the words are exactly the way they're copied right out of the lectionary, so that we follow the rule of the Catholic Church of singing the exact words of this prayer. So we'll be using this today. Thank you, Julia and Adam, and behind the scenes, Fred, for keeping us on the screens.
Good evening. Welcome to St. Andrew as we celebrate the 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time. I'm Carmen Bergoglio, and I will be serving as a lector for this Mass. Our music will be led by Stefan Paul, accompanied by Genesis. The presider for this liturgy is Monsignor Mike, assisted by Deacon Mark. As a reminder, reception of communion in the hand is strongly recommended. Those receiving on the tongue are asked to wait to be at the end of the line. To minimize distractions during the Mass, we ask you to silence all cell phones and personal devices. I invite you to now stand and greet your neighbor.
I say yes, my Lord, to every word you say. Good afternoon, everyone. We come together to offer our worship and praise to God. We come together to get nourished at the table of the Word and the table of the Eucharist. In a special way, we keep in our minds, our thoughts, our prayers, those people in Haiti struggling with not only the earthquake, but the tropical storms, and the people in Afghanistan who are struggling with that turmoil in the country. We pray, too, in a special way this week for our children who are going back to school and their teachers. So let's begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you.
And with your spirit.
My friends, as we gather around this sacred altar, we first call to mind our sins and ask for the Lord's mercy and forgiveness in our lives.
Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins and failings. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Cause the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose. Grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered together all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, summoning their elders, their leaders, their judges, and their officers. When they stood in ranks before God, Joshua addressed all the people. If it does not please you to serve the Lord, decide today whom you will serve, the gods of your fathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose country you are now dwelling. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. But the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord for the service of other gods, for it was the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up out of the land of Egypt, out of a state of slavery. He performed those great miracles before our very eyes and protected us along our entire journey and among the people through whom we passed. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, live in love as Christ loved us. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church, and handed himself over for her to sanctify her, cleansing her by the bath of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So also husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one hates his own flesh, but rather nourishes and cherishes it, even as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you.
Many of Jesus' disciples who were listening said, "This saying is hard. Who can accept it?" Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, "Does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe." Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe, and the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by my Father." As a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. Jesus then said to the 12, "Do you also want to leave?" Simon Peter answered him, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I think you'd agree with me in thinking that children have a hard time knowing what's good for them, don't they? It takes a little time, it takes a little practice. We know the stories, we've experienced them ourselves probably. Vegetables, well, they taste terrible. Telling the truth, it just gets me into more trouble. Homework, complete waste of time. Chores, guess what? Things are just gonna get dirty all over again. No running near the swimming pool takes all the fun out of it, doesn't it? Saying I'm sorry, I don't even mean it. Taking a bath, hey, I don't smell that bad, Mom, Dad. How can you blame them? They don't know any better. They haven't lived long enough to know better. They haven't had enough life experiences yet. They haven't had enough time to learn from their mistakes and their lapses of judgment. But for most of us, we eventually come around, eventually come to start understanding what is truly in our best interest, what we should actually be doing. And so for many of us, we try to eat well. We try to get enough sleep. We try to get our exercise and obey the laws and show up for work and pay our bills and take care of our homes and our yards and take regular showers and take our medication when we're supposed to and all sorts of things like that. After all, we want what's best for us, right? The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. That's what we hear in today's gospel, Jesus telling his disciples. He knew that they'd been, what he had been telling them, all sorts of things, were very hard for them to accept as we've gone through this bread of life discourse from the evangelist John. All those stories that he was saying seemed to turn their world upside down. He was saying strange things that seemed to go against their collective common sense, what they understood, go against the way they were taught to believe things, how they were brought up, you know, how they understood the world to work. And then they'd seen the miracles too, and they must have scratched their head a lot because that got their attention, but often made them even more confused about this friend of theirs, this Jesus fellow. And just before today's particular statement from Jesus, the disciples had heard him go on and on about how he was the bread that came down from heaven. What could that possibly mean? Put yourselves in their place, in their shoes, in their sandals, if you will. What could that possibly mean? And now they were getting very confused, really confused, and probably wondered if their Jesus friend wasn't maybe a little bit out of his right mind. Maybe there was something wrong with him. I know if I was there, I probably would be thinking that if I was truly honest with all of you. And so Jesus does what? He tries to reassure all of them. He even goes so far as to ask them, "Does this shock you?" I would have been thinking, "Yes, it does." That was, in a sense, of Jesus' way of telling them, "I know that what these things that I've been telling you are difficult for you to understand. I know that you're puzzled. You're wondering whether or not you should be still paying attention to what I have to say. You must be wondering if I still have all my senses about me. I know that I'm challenging you in ways that you've never been challenged before." And Jesus would be thinking, "I get all that. And I need you to stay with me. Need you to do your best to accept what I'm saying, because guess what? The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life." We, when we hear those words today, we have to ask ourselves, do we truly believe that in our hearts? It's kind of ironic how, for most things in this life, we tend to grow from a state of not understanding what's good for us to a state of greater understanding. The older we get, the more life experiences that we have. We know that if we touch that hot stove, it is hot and we're going to burn ourselves. But maybe the first couple of times that happened in our life, we didn't truly understand or we didn't believe what our parents and grandparents were telling us. We knew that we had to be doing certain things and then refrain from doing other things in order to have the best and the safest life possible. Yet often, my friends, when it comes to spiritual things, the things of God that we talk about, that we celebrate, we sometimes do the exact opposite. And so for many of us, myself included at times, we loosen our grip on these holy things with each passing year. Think back in your own lives, if you will. For many of us, our youth was filled with big, selfless dreams about changing the world and caring for the less fortunate and sacrificing for the good of others and making a real and lasting difference in our world. But then with the passage of time, what happens? Many of us start to drift away from that kind of perspective. We begin telling ourselves that it's because we know what the real world demands. And that's the master that we often start serving, the one that makes sure our worldly needs are met above all, sometimes so many times over that we really can't even use all that we have. We pursue these things endlessly in our lives, sometimes exclusively in our lives, and then pass them on to the next generation who does the same thing and on and so forth in the service of, well, you start scratching your head and say, in service of exactly what? Love your enemies. Turn the other cheek. Give from your want and not from your excess. Forgive 70 times seven times. Lay down your life for your friends. Go that extra mile. These are precisely the words that are spirit in life. Words that can help us be fully alive. Words that if we really take them to heart and really try to live them out in our daily lives, will help us live in the way, the only way that God really intended, that made life truly worth living. The way he wanted us to live, the way he died for us to live. Our God who died to save us and show us the power of that depth of love. And that takes faith. And faith is sometimes we forget to work on, because faith is a relationship that we have with God. My friends, this afternoon as we listen to these words from Scripture, today is a challenge for each and every one of us. An invitation to look deeper within and examine to what degree we're really on board with what Jesus has been asking us to do. Can we echo those words of Joshua that Carmen proclaimed for us from our first reading today and truly mean them? As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Or do we think our way is better? Do we think that the world's way is better? We don't really have a choice. We're going to wind up serving somebody one way or another, whether we want to or not, whether we plan to do it or not, whether we think about it or not. But the question we might walk away with this week is, who will that someone be? Amen. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us, for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My friends, having listened to God's word, let us with courage and faith now bring these, our prayers and petitions, before him.
For the church, drawn from all nations and languages, may God richly bless us as we proclaim the fidelity and praise of the Lord to all peoples. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to violence in the world, especially in Afghanistan, that God will preserve them from bloodshed, open communication and dialogue, and fill hearts with hope. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those impacted by natural disasters, especially those from the earthquake in Haiti, that God will give them strength, renew their hope, and touch the hearts of many to assist them. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are beginning a new academic year, that students and teachers may learn together as they grow in wisdom, peace, and love. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish of families, St. Andrew, St. Irenaeus, and St. Mary of the Hills, that we may place the needs and welfare of others ahead of our own interest, just as Christ laid down his life out of love for us. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially those suffering from COVID-19, may they feel the power of Jesus' healing embrace. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead, especially Barbara Harrington, may they take their place at the eternal feast in the kingdom of God. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intercessions placed in our prayer basket, and for Charles Dunn, Bill Zandi, and Debbie Sotka, for whom this Mass is offered. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. O Almighty and Eternal Father, you call us to share in the eternal life of your kingdom, trusting that your desire for us is mercy and steadfast love. We make our prayers, both spoken and those known only to you, with confidence and hope. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. My brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice in your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
With your
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For although you have no need of our praise, yet our thanksgiving is itself your gift, since our praises add nothing to your greatness, but profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. name of the Lord, in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, in recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Andrew, St. Irenaeus, St. Mary of the Hills, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Alan, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Now, gathering all our prayers and praise into one, we offer the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us share with one another a sign of the peace of Christ.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
For those at home, a prayer for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present at the Most Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you in my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
love poured out his blood. Give us a sign that we might believe in you. Moses had manna from the sky.
From the cloud you speak, what was veiled now is seen. Jesus, the image of the invisible God.
Divinity confirmed. Word.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us so that in all things we may please you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple of short announcements. We're taking up the collection for religious assistance to Poland and Polonia this weekend. There's envelopes by the doors of the church, so if you want to contribute, take an envelope home, bring it back next week. That's great. And then next week, too, we'll take up a collection for the people of Haiti. A lot of people have been asking, what can we do? And usually we funnel our charity through the Catholic Relief Services, and that's what they've asked us to do. And so there's no envelope in your packet for it, so just put it in a regular envelope or just a regular check or something like that and mark on it for Haiti relief, and then we'll know how to distribute it once we go through the collection next week. So I thank you very much for your charity there to help them all out. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you on your journeys, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let us go in peace, glorifying the Lord Jesus by our lives.
Thanks be to God.
Strive, hear us shouting glory above the pagan horn.